Well, good afternoon and welcome to this final panel discussion of the 60th SKOCH Summit, which is policy making for a 5 trillion economy. It's a very appropriate kind of a topic because I think most of the times we find that the growth is being held back because of policy flaws. You know, the policy intent is something else, the implementation is something else. And what people need, what I describe as the felt need, is a third beast altogether. And unless and until we are able to get all the three things together, this growth is not going to happen. So I have a very distinguished panel again. I have an entrepreneur, Mr. Ravi Rajagopalan. I think he's a fintech entrepreneur who came back from UK and is wanting to do some stuff in India. I have Dr. Lavish Bhandari, very eminent economist. He has a fairly wide repertoire of services, but these days he's focused on environment, but his knowledge on economic issues is almost like an encyclopedia. We have Dr. Praveen N. Gidam, who is additional CEO, National Health Authority. He's about only a month old, but he's heading one of the most crucial schemes. Possibly the next election winner for this government is going to be National Health Mission. So he's in the hot seat on that one. We have Mr. Sanjay Jaju, who's Joint Secretary in Department of Defense. I think 20 billion out of that is going to come. 25 billion is his target out of the 5 trillion. So how is he planning to do that? And we have Mr. Tanuj Bhojwani, core volunteer of iSpert Foundation. And they do a lot of work around technology policy for India. In fact, some of the sectors are a direct result of their work. So while we will go to the audience round, I would like to start off this discussion actually with Ravi Rajagopalan. Now, Ravi, you are the only one who's done some business as an entrepreneur. I mean, we kind of pussyfooted around it, but you actually put your hard money and hard work around that. So if you could just tell your story, I mean, why did you come from UK to India? Why, and what's the journey been? And are you frustrated? Are you happy? Are you laughing all the way to the bank? What's your story?
My background is telecommunications. I was educated in India, but you know, Indian education is actually very, very good, and it puts you on par with anyone anywhere in the world. So I worked for a company which doesn't exist called Lucent Technologies, which at one point in time was a stock market star. So I spent most of my life building CDMA and wideband CDMA networks. And after a series of mergers in 2010, I got tired of being a corporate bureaucrat. I had a nice apartment in Paris, and I said, you know, there's more to life than this. So driven by a dream, and I know how cliched it sounds, but driven by a dream, I thought I would come back to India, make my home here again after many years, and see if I could build something. So I've always been a product person. I've never worked in the services industry in my life. I've always, telecom is about products. So I wanted to set up something that would deliver a product-based service to the economy, focused on the unbanked. And so I set up, built this thing called IMT, which is a network of ATMs that operates without a card. And we have the distinction of being the only payment system that is licensed as a settlement agency by the Reserve Bank of India. So the frustrations and the dreams can be divided into two parts. So as an entrepreneur, the thing that really frustrates you is, in order to create real domestic value add, it helps to create intellectual property. You need to build products, build technologies that are uniquely Indian. The whole premise of Make in India, Dr. Jaju's whole plan for defense production is based on Indian entrepreneurs creating Indian products. To summarize, I don't think that the ecosystem in India it works towards product entrepreneurs. It works for service entrepreneurs. It works for business model entrepreneurs. Like Paytm is nothing but a Chinese funded business model. Sorry for being direct. But it is not an Indian innovation. So the innovation ecosystem in this country is very poor. The second thing we suffered from is a huge amount of regulatory lack of clarity. And through the NPCI, we actually face government competition all the time. You cannot compete against the government. The good part of it is that the Reserve Bank of India preserves its independence fairly jealously, and they're always good about listening to entrepreneurs and listening to a point of view. So these are the good things and the bad things. I'm here because I have a huge amount of hope for this country. I think this is the most amazing country on the planet. There's so much of hope here. We have stability. We have people who are savers, who are risk takers, who are hard workers. And I think there's been much that can be done out of this very potent mix of people and policy and intent. I'm very, very happy to see the drive towards $5 trillion because we all know it is very hard given where the economy is today. But I'm a believer in big goals. And I have only two data points that I would, you know, two inspirations that I have in mind when I think of big goals. One, because I'm a good Tamil boy, there is the Thiruvalluvar, Tamil saint, who said, Devatal Aha Deninum, Muyarchita Mevaratha Kuli Tharum. It means if the task is very, very big, which even the gods think cannot be accomplished, your individual effort produces more than its rewards. I think that's very, very powerful. And the second is President John F. Kennedy in September 1962, speaking in Texas about the goal to put a man on the moon, he said, we wish to go to the moon and do this thing and all the other things, not because it is easy, but because it is hard. And when you do something that is hard, it helps focus the mind, it helps focus the resources. I don't think we should be afraid of attempting a $5 trillion transition. We should go for it. And if we fall short, I would rather that we fell short through good effort than falling short because we just didn't bother to try at all.
Ravi is from the fintech industry. And, you know, he came with a lot of hopes. In fact, in fintech is, I think, one area where you've had a very large number of startups, thanks to the work that people like iSpurt, etc. have done, where the whole dream was that the entire financial business model would change. We'll move towards digital transactions more and more. The velocity of money will go up. So everyone came into it with a lot of hopes and dreams. And surprisingly, it is not the market that has let them down, it's not the country, but I think it's mostly the policy flip-flops. So one of the things that happened, he was that, you know, we have NPCI, which we don't seem to be making up our mind whether it's a regulator or a competitor. You can't have NPCI doing both. And if they want to be a service provider, then there is clearly a need for a regulator on top of that. Now, this is something that no one had really bargained for. So while all of them depend on the NPCI infrastructure to offer their services, they end up willy-nilly competing with NPCI for the same slice of cake. And obviously, they will be far more competitive than they can ever imagine to be. So that's one part of the problem. The second part of the policy flip-flop is that the entire fintech dream was the Aadhaar dream. In fact, everything was supposed to get Aadhaar-enabled. Onboarding customers was to become very easy. eKYC was allowed. And a lot of work happened by people like iSpurt in creating the India stack to enable that. And then we have this, you know, same problem, which is not just in fintech. You have a very, very aggressive civil society system, which is not bad. And you also have a very active judiciary. And the problem with it is that they may not understand the complexities of the issues involved, or they may not be willing to negotiate. So the emphasis more is on destruction. So if this is happening and I don't like it for these three reasons, so rather than looking at how do I make it work or how do I make it work better, I'll say, no, let's kill this first and then let's talk. Right? So you know that Aadhaar got thrown out of Supreme Court as for usage in anything which is other than out of Consolidated Fund of India. So there went the entire case of the financial fintech sector, so to say. So how do you think policy making can be improved? I mean, what do we do?
It's not about $5 trillion economy, really. I mean, the $5 trillion is the first day of a five-day match or a longer this thing. We have to think about 10, 15, 20 billion, of course, with longer horizons. But there is a very strange way that our country functions. At the center is the executive. Then there's a judiciary, there's a set of laws, there's the regulator, or there are the non-regulators, there is, and so on and so forth. And in many different areas in our country, the divisions between all of them are not very well defined. So as a result, I'll talk about the environment for a minute, and I'll come back to your questions. There is the Ministry of Environment in the central government. There is the CPCB. There is the National Green Tribunal. And then there is the Supreme Court. And all of them are addressing environment-related matters. And sometimes the same matter is addressed by all four entities simultaneously. The CPCB, the Central Pollution Control Board, also has some control over the State Pollution Control Board, but it never uses that control. So essentially, the whole system, to an outsider, might seem messy. But till now, this system has been working very well. And why? Because actually, behind the scenes, there have been people who have been talking to each other. There is an interaction process. It's long drawn out and so on. That process works very well when you're aiming at a 3-5% economy in the long run. Dheere dheere chal raha hai, ho raha hai, etc. But the last 10 to 20 years, 20 years especially, this system is increasingly coming under stress because for a 7-8% or a 10% growth economy, you need the system to work very, very fast. The problem that you talked about, the Supreme Court, the problem was not that the Supreme Court decided against Aadhaar. The problem was in the need to push through Aadhaar very fast, the Aadhaar law was drafted very badly on the basis of the law that was passed by the parliament. There's nothing else it could do. So we have to think about, one, expertise. Second, removing these fuzzy areas between the regulator, the bureaucracy, and so on. And the path to 5 trillion and 10 trillion is removing these fuzziness. And I will talk about one important element in this, which increasingly this government and the past governments have all been hurtling towards, is an era where the expert is of no use. Expertise or the technocrat is becoming successively less and less valued, is asked for his advice or his consulting much more less than it used to be in the past. Laws used to be drafted with far more care in the past than they are now. Policies, there was a lot of thought that used to happen than is happening right now. And it could be due to a whole range of reasons, but the 5 trillion economy requires us that the experts, the technocrats, actually are given a patient hearing to.
You can keep that. So coming to you, Tanuj, so what Lavish has just said, that it was a badly drafted law. Now the worst thing that you can do with a badly drafted law is to put an honest bureaucrat on top of implementing it. So you have this terrible Aadhaar Act, terribly drafted Aadhaar Act, and then you had some really strict and honest bureaucrats implementing it. So you find that, you know, so many journalists have FIRs against them, so many others have FIRs against them. I mean, at time it was almost considered seditious to say something was wrong with Aadhaar. The fact is, the Aadhaar Act should have been more participatory while you were drafting it. More people would have been given a more patient hearing, and maybe these problems would not have happened at that point in time. But, you know, people like iSpert are young people. We are in a hurry. You know, India is growing at 5% and that is just not acceptable to us. We want it to grow at 9%, 10%. So when we come with the corporate expertise or technical expertise from inside, we are actually trying to transform the country. So if the law was bad, could something have been done? Could you have been more participative in your approach? What is your learning on how do you balance these two things?
So, see, where iSpirit stands in the ecosystem is that we provide a much needed expertise, I would say, especially in the last 10 years, through the rise of ICT technologies, through the rise of digital, mobile, smartphone, there is now a new approach to solving age-old problems. This new approach is not very well understood by the policymakers and by the executive, the bureaucrat, right? Now, one building on what Lavish is saying is that you have these problems of jurisdiction, but you also have an HR problem because the people manning this barely get time to understand what they're stepping into, and it's time to leave again. So it's a helpless merry-go-round, right? Like you have IS officers who have to step in and understand this tangle of a mess of problem and they are under pressure to perform, right? The finance secretary goes out in 5 months, new one comes in, and he's in the middle of a crisis, right? And he's expected to become an expert on that very, very fast. So I want to add that complication. When you have that complication, you have people who use their judgment to say, this is enough. This is enough of a law. This is enough of a program. This is enough of a thing. So here, I agree with the ideas that being more participative, bringing in more experts, making a more well-rounded approach could possibly lead to ideas. But I want to say something contentious, is that the Aadhaar Act came in 2016. Aadhaar came in 2009-10. For the first 4 years till 2014, that act did not pass for political reasons based on who was the opposition, what are the numbers in parliament. When the house composition flipped, a law came into being. And then again, it was funny enough, opposed by the opposition then, post 2014, who were responsible for getting that piece of that program out there. So this, and there's a quote by one famous politician who says, where I stand on the issue depends on where I sit. And that summarizes our take on important programs, right? There's nothing which is bipartisan anymore. There is nothing which can be allowed to, you can look at it simply of its merits and demerits. And that too is framing our policies and is detrimental to all of us in the long run, right? So what could have been done? Of course, we could have been more participative. Of course, we could have done this. But can we depoliticize certain issues? Can we make them about individually about their merits and demerits and not also embroil them in the larger cultural war that is happening, on the election agenda?
Okay. Yeah.
I'd like to say one thing on this. Perhaps we are too participative. We are listening to everyone. My point about expertise was, the expert has spent a lot of time and effort and has a lot of more depth than a whole range of people whom we try to listen to in the participative approach. So there is an element of democracy in the participative approach, but sometimes we do too much of it.
I meant participative in terms of experts. We were not planning to have a referendum on Aadhaar, but the thing is that if there are 10 people who've done nothing but similar systems in their life, then at the least we have spoken to those 10 systems. And I think one of the crucial things that was missing in this entire, and the reason we are spending so much of time on this, is so that the same mistakes does not get repeated. We get it right the second time. We should not get it right there. So there was a technical angle to it. There was a legislative angle to it. There was an economic compulsion to it. However, what was missing was the sociological aspect. So I think there was a need for a certain amount of socio-economic consultation as well as to anthropologically, culturally, how will people take it. And the issue actually got hijacked by something which according to me is a non-issue. I mean, it became all about surveillance, etc. Actually, it was not about surveillance at all. The main issue was that is my data with Aadhaar safe and can somebody misuse it? So that is something that never really became the basis of a judgment. What became the basis of judgment was whether it is going to make India a surveillance state or it is not going to make India a surveillance state, even though the Aadhaar Act doesn't mention this anywhere that it is to be used in that context. So that's a great learning for everybody, that there is a need for wider participation while you're developing and designing such schemes, because what is missing from that is the felt needs. That is what sociologists who are almost never consulted on anything bring to the table. So you talk to the economist, you talk to the technologist, you talk to the lawyer, but you don't talk to the sociologist who will say, but listen, I think people need this and this is how they're going to react to it. And this is my problem with all sandbox approaches that is going on, including the sandbox that RBI set up, that tomorrow you come up with a great fintech idea, but people say, no, this is damaging to me in this, this and this way. So there is no sociological oversight of that. So with that, sorry, we can clear that later. Come to Sanjay Jaju. Now you're making a 25 billion plan. So obviously you're writing a policy. And we've seen how the fintech policies kind of got derailed and coming back on tracks. So when you make a policy and an entrepreneur like Ravi comes into India, you come with certain business assumptions. You know that I am going to get a certain return on my investment. I am not going to compete with so-and-so. My onboarding of customer is going to have a direct implication on my cost. So my cost on this is this. And finally, what is the return? So I get an MDR, which is the fee that I can charge to the customer. And then you suddenly realize that the Payments and Settlement Act gets changed and say MDR becomes zero from tomorrow morning on any turnover over 50 crores. eKYC is no longer possible because Supreme Court says so. Now I have to compete with my regulator because NPCI decides to do the service and the regulation. Now it's a landmine. It is not the situation in defense yet because you're starting afresh. So how would you take care of these problems? Because if you're looking at indigenous manufacturing and people are going to invest billions of dollars based on certain assumptions from the policy that you write, how do you ensure that, first of all, the policy making itself is participatory, people can actually implement it? And secondly, having written the policy, how do you ensure policy stability?
Let's just settle the Aadhaar debate, because I'm also quite passionate about it, because I was the one who issued the first Aadhaar in the country, and actually I was instrumental in getting the last Aadhaar to the state where I've actually worked, in Andhra Pradesh. So Aadhaar is a great technology piece, and with the legal deficiencies which have now been broadly overcome with the Supreme Court guidelines and the judgment and the recent act that has been done, Aadhaar is a great technology stack that can enable not just financial transactions, can also enable direct benefits, which is happening, transfer of the direct benefits. At the same time, it's also helping in removing the inclusion and the exclusion errors that were there so heavily in our system. So to an extent, we should all embrace Aadhaar as it is, and with the safeguard that have now been built into it, I think it can be definitely used not just for the delivery of public services, but can also be used for delivery of a lot of these private services. And I'm absolutely sure somebody would be very keen to get an eKYC done making use of an Aadhaar rather than going through a rigmarole of a huge procedure. And when you cut down that time, it ultimately adds to the velocity of money that you've been talking of. Coming back to the 5 trillion economy debate in my current role in the defense production, you know, when we say 5 trillion economy for the country, obviously you've broken it up into different pieces, into different sectors. And when you say 5 trillion economy for the country, you're also talking in terms of a 1 trillion economy for manufacturing in the country. 1 trillion comes from manufacturing. So if 1 trillion has to come from manufacturing, how does it break up? And we feel that for 1 trillion manufacturing economy dream to be realized, we need to create a $25 billion. That is 2.5% of that has to come from defense and aerospace. Now, why I use aerospace? Because defense and aerospace are quite heavily intertwined. It's very difficult to draw a distinction between the civilian and the military aerospace. So for the sake of simplicity, I will use the two things together. Now, when we say we need to create a $25 billion economy for manufacturing, we have to put together a lot of pieces. Policy is one of the pieces. But when it comes to defense, the problem is the uncertainties are much higher than what you see in a regular market. It's an absolute monopsony. It's a market where there's only one buyer, that's the government. So when an industry intends to bring in investment in defense, it has to not just guard against the uncertainties of product development, but it has to also guard against the uncertainties of the market. Because here you only have one buyer, and the needs of that buyer may change because they are dynamic. So to an extent, these are the situations that one has to guard against. And when we make policies, we have to ensure that the policy is aligned with the coping mechanisms required to meet with the uncertainties that come with the monopsony kind of a market. Now, let me just give you a quick picture into how this $25 billion dream gets realized when it comes to defense. You know, we have broadly some capital requirement, and very happy to tell you now that the default mode now in the defense is called as Buy Indian IDDM. Buy Indian IDDM is spelled as Indian Designed, Developed and Manufactured. And that's a default mode. If you have an analysis of what has been procured over the last, say, 5 years, you would know that almost 75% of what has been procured comes through the Buy IDDM route. And that's where the manufacturing is going to come from. That's where the manufacturing is going to happen in the country. But if you look at it, the constraint is always going to be the numbers. When you have a GDP breakup, the national wealth is divided into what you have as exports, what is the private consumption, then you have the investment and the government expenditure. Now, if these four, if you look at it in this $5 billion defense economy, the problem is the private consumption piece is also part of the government expenditure because this is totally being bought by the government. So that is why what we are trying to give focus now on is for our economy, for our defense and manufacturing economy to start looking at the global market, the global arms market, which in itself is very huge. And so that we remove this uncertainty piece from the minds of the industry which are producing for defense and aerospace sectors. So that's where the exports come in a very large number. So when we are looking at a $25 billion of defense and aerospace economy, we are actually looking at $5 billion to come in from exports. And it's not so bad, because currently we are standing at $2 billion of exports. So that $2 billion can easily be taken to $5 billion, because this $2 billion was only about $200 million about 2 years back. That means in the last 2 years, we have grown almost tenfold in terms of the defense exports. And that to an extent is going to give us not just competitiveness, but it will also allow our companies to grow and develop products which could be utilized by the militaries world over. Coming back to the aerospace now, I think India is easily the fastest growing civil aviation economy in the world. In terms of the passenger traffic, possibly by 2020, we will be the third largest economy in the world. Civilian aircrafts, we currently have about 800 civilian aircrafts. And in the next 15 to 20 years, we got to add close to 2,000 aircrafts in this economy. And that's a kind of a number that's mind-boggling. And I'm sure this number is not going to come through imports, because it's not possible for the country to afford these numbers. So a lot of it got to be produced within the country. If not the platforms, at least the systems, the subsystems, the components are all going to be manufactured and would have to be manufactured in the country. If nothing, at least the MRO work is going to be happening in the country, because you cannot afford to maintain close to 3,000 civilian aircrafts somewhere else, somewhere outside. So to a very large extent, these pieces are the ones which are going to contribute to this $1 billion economy, $25 billion economy. From the policy perspective, what is it that we are doing? A is to push our forces to buy from India. And that's what is happening. Close to 80% of all our purchases are now happening through the Buy Indian route. Secondly, to put an embargo on certain things that we were buying earlier from outside and say that these items from 2024 are only going to be bought in India. For example, artillery guns. I mean, gone are the days when we were buying Bofors and stuff. Now, it's artillery guns are completely produced within the country. A lot of electronics is completely produced within the country. Even there are a lot of small arms which are being produced in the country. All kinds of ammunition is produced within the country. So to an extent, there are a lot of items on which an embargo has been put that these items are only going to be bought through the domestic manufacturing sector. Then how do you bring in investment? The FDI policy has been kind of completely liberalized. Now you have 49% as an automatic route. That means a foreign OEM can bring in 49% investment into defense sector, not aerospace. Aerospace is 100%. While in defense, 49% of investment can be brought in under the automatic route, and even 100% investment can be brought in through the government route, and which is also not very difficult, because now we don't have the FIPB. The approvals are all given at our level in the government, within the ministry. So to an extent, the foreign investment regime has been liberalized, and with the problems happening in between US and China, we expect a lot of manufacturing lines of the global OEMs to move from US and other countries and come to India because of the arbitrage that India offers, and also being a huge economy in itself and a huge consumption system that India offers in terms of defense. So to an extent, a lot of these OEMs also have huge interest in India, and they are also kind of coming in and investing in India. Even on the FDI side, the kind of foreign investment that has been received in defense and aerospace from 2001 till 2014, And if you compare it with what we have received post 2014, the number is almost similar. That means we have received almost the same amount of investment into defense and aerospace in 5 years, which we received over the last 20 years. So again, these are the signs and which gives us promise that investments are possible. And foreign OEMs are looking at India because of the market and the labor reforms also, which are possibly going to be coming in, which are going to be helping the manufacturing ecosystem. Last bit is on the policy side would always be to create clusters. You know, defense is one peculiar segment which always develops through a cluster approach, because you know you have producers in the tier one, then you have the tier two vendors, and you have the tier three vendors, and eventually the product comes out. There needs to be a testing mechanism, the testing facilities which are completely government owned. And then there are a lot of regulatory issues, because when it comes to aeronautical, the quality assurance and the requirement is fairly strict and stringent. And then you have the forces, because you know a product which might be suitable for a civilian market, but when it comes to the military use, it has to be a completely different standard, because the military ruggedness is completely a different dimension if you compare it with a civilian kind of a thing. So you have to have an ecosystem, create a cluster where all these prongs can possibly stay together. And I think that's where these two defense clusters that we have announced last year, one in Tamil Nadu and one in Uttar Pradesh, are also going to be of huge importance for us to bring in investment into the defense and manufacturing economy. And I'll just give you a small example. I mean, we have been buying AK series, the Kalashnikovs, the assault rifles. We have all heard of them. We've all seen them in televisions and in movies. It's a very good situation now that these Kalashnikovs are now going to be manufactured in India. Until now, we were completely importing from outside. But these now Kalashnikovs are now getting manufactured in India. So that means foreign OEMs have understood that there is a Make in India resolve. The country is not going to buy indiscriminately as it was doing earlier. And unless and until there is a domestic manufacturing system embedded within a particular purchase, the defense forces are not going to buy. I think all these factors would eventually contribute to give us this flip and make us move from a current 13 trillion economy into a $25 billion economy over the next 5 to 6 years.
Well, thank you, Mr. Jaju. But you know, to my mind, defense is a relatively simpler sector, because you know, you can set a standard, you can take a decision, and when everything else fails, you face any opposition, you can always say national security, and then you can push your decision through. But if you look at a more complicated and a dirtier sector like health, which Mr. Gaidam has just joined the National Health Authority, and you look at one of possibly the best performing schemes where the policy design itself is very good as of just now, is the Ayushman Bharat scheme. And we've studied ourselves, we've gone across the country looking at it, and we find that the scheme is doing exceedingly well. So Mr. Gaidam, what do you think is making Ayushman Bharat deliver? At least the part that you're looking after.
Okay. Thanks for having me here. It's been a great success. Less than 1 year that scheme has been launched, and we have already treated more than 40 lakh 4 million people inpatient, and treatment costing to more than 6,500 crore rupees, which has resulted in the saving to those poor families to the extent of almost 12,000 crore rupees. So it's a sort of game changer. And what has made this possible? We had some schemes earlier, but I think the most important thing is to have very simple policy with too much of clarity. So we know for sure which hospital is likely to be empaneled and which hospital is not likely to empanel. There is no gray area, one. Two, the processes are defined again in a very simplistic manner on a platform, technological platform, rather than pushing files. So if a hospital applies, either you accept that empanelment or reject it within a given time frame, or we are sitting there on the top of it and getting it done. So there is a certain amount of clarity the way things are moving. So if a patient gets admitted and he is eligible, so his payment, most of the cases, we are monitoring it because of beautiful IT platform that we have. So there is assurance that the payment will be done in 15 days. So all these things were lacking in maybe earlier schemes, or in fact, there was no scheme of this scale before this, the scheme involving 54 crore people. So I think this has made this possible to take it to this level in 11 months. Part two, we want to ensure that things don't crumble down in future. So like the gentleman said ki policy flip-flop ho jata hai, what do you do? A very crucial part of my scheme is how much I pay to the hospital for a given procedure. And here a lot of things are in gray areas, which we try to convert either into black or white. Whether a lady requires hysterectomy, whether her uterus should be removed or not removed. It's a very subjective decision, and you simply cannot go and see after one day or two days whether the decision on part of doctor was right or wrong. And how do you ensure that these malpractices don't creep into it? So we are now looking into a standard treatment workflows or SOPs of health interventions, which will give more clarity to these aspects. Then obviously we will also have to ensure a hospital is investing something. This is a whole new set of patients, a class which was not accessing private healthcare so far. And all of a sudden, 50 crore of them are able to access a private hospital, which they were otherwise not. So if a private industry comes up to match these expectations, and tomorrow I say, okay, I am paying 8,000 rupees for cataract, from tomorrow it will be 4,000 rupees. So things will collapse. So we don't want that to happen. So we are having a continuous consultation with industries. And we want to have as much of objectivity as possible to have these very, very complex health costs to be determined, so that industry is also able to see in future what is my cost that I will be getting for this procedure in future. And we also want to be predictable. So I think the way forward is to, we already have a good IT system, as I told, but to make it more robust and to increase its scope, that's a separate topic altogether, I will not touch it. And again, to bring in a objectivity and predictability into a system which already is a very complex with lot of gray areas.
Alok, you've been a very seasoned, wise person looking at the government for many, many years in your term at various finance commissions, your job at Indian Institute of Public Administration. And you know, so, one thing you would agree with me, that when you have a very good performing scheme in the government, what's the biggest risk it faces? You know, it possibly attracts attention of everybody else who would want it to fail. Okay, so I am saying if the scheme is performing well in the government.
Okay, whatever. Thank you, Sameer.
So there are others who would want it to fail, so they can quickly jump into it. So how do you protect a well-performing scheme from government?
What my perception is about this 5 trillion economy, the Modi first, the first 5 years, more of clearing the systems. So they cleared the systems, and this Modi 2 is more of the growth part of it. And this 5 trillion is not something which is unrealistic, but certainly there was some hindrances and some enablers. The gentleman sitting on my right, you were talking about the hindrances, and Lavish was talking about the enablers, the kind of enablers that we have with us. Sameer, you said this Aadhaar is badly drafted legislations. I would say that there was no legislation before. Now they introduced the legislation before this. So that's what all has happened. Whenever you go fast, you generally stumble. In India, you very rightly said, whenever you wanted to set any kind of policies, it generally take 10 years. I remember that if you wanted to introduce the value-added tax, It was first introduced in 1986, then the tax reform committee was set up, and then there was another team set up. They submitted the report, and there were various committees, including the finance minister, chief ministers. So finally, they were able to introduce in 2005. So it took 20 years to introduce the value-added tax. And in order to include the services within the value-added tax, they took another 10 years or so, maybe 12 years or so. So the democracy, it has its own price. But as Lavish has very rightly said, you know, now there is a very little scope for experts in this. So the government wanted to put things on a fast track, and the literature written by person like Amartya Sen, argumentative Indians and others, has very little place now. So the government is there, they know that all policies are there with us, because what happened before, there was very little institutional memories, as Mr. Sanjay Jaju will agree with me, that the minister is announcing that there has to be a working group on the subject. And some people down the line, they were whispering that there was a task force 20 years ago on the same subject. Okay. So you were just moving, you know, in the same, you know, moving in circles. Now this government is very decisive, and they're taking decisions, and they were removing the hurdles. So I think this kind of target is easy, and there were not many institutions who had to clear the policies. I think that's the kind of question that you were asking. For example, we had planning commission in the past.
You actually very neatly skirted my question, or maybe you didn't hear it. I said National Health Authority, Ayushman Bharat, is a very well-performing scheme. Mm-hmm. And in my experience, what happens is that when in the government, one department has a good scheme, then three other departments try to derail it. So that's the biggest instability risk. I'll give you an example vis-a-vis Ayushman Bharat itself. So it would have three components, my understanding. One is the piece that Mr. Gedam is looking after, which is the finance, settlement, putting everything together piece. Second piece is the physical delivery infrastructure. So while you have put this and you put so much money in everybody's pocket, do we have enough doctors, nurses, hospitals, diagnosis centers, etc., to be able to cater to that enhanced demand? That, unfortunately, is not his job. That is somebody else's job. So while he can see the demand being generated, he can do nothing about fulfilling that demand. Because that's somebody else's job. And the third piece is that both these things have to work together. So now there's a third beast called National Digital Health Mission, which kind of brings everything together. Now, whether this is a part of them, is it a part of the guys who are doing infrastructure, or is it a third body? So my real worry is that I hope that with this overdoing the policy bit, we don't end up damaging very good schemes like Ayushman Bharat, and we've seen it in several areas earlier. Because the problem is, first of all, there is very little capacity within the government to understand what is needed to be done. So you spend a lot of time explaining to them ke bhaiya ye karna hai, ye desh ke liye achha hai. But the minute they understand what is to be done, you will find that 15 officers want to do the same thing in 15 different departments. Artificial intelligence is a classic case. So you don't know ke data localization, AI, ab ye Ministry of External Affairs ka kaam hai, ye Niti Aayog ka kaam hai, ye MeitY ka kaam hai, ye NIC ka kaam hai. एक टाइम ऐसा था जब ये किसी का भी काम नहीं था, और आज का टाइम ऐसा है कि आपस में लड़ रहे हैं कि किसका काम है. तो जब किसी का काम नहीं था तो वो हो नहीं रहा था, अब जब लड़ाई हो रही है तो शायद नहीं होगा. सो माय क्वेश्चन टू यू वाज, हाउ डू यू अवॉइड समथिंग लाइक दैट?
समीर, आई थिंक पर्सन सिटिंग ऑन योर लेफ्ट विल एग्री विद मी. यू नो, व्हेन the country got the independence, there were hardly these line ministries there at New Delhi. They were all the ministries like Home Affairs, Finance, Defense and others. Now we have ministries on the state subjects there at New Delhi. And since you have a large amount of bureaucracy and they need some certain kind of employment, the file moves from one place to another. When you interrupted, I was just talking about the planning commission, the earlier planning commissions. And I was sitting yesterday there at Niti Aayog, and one of the correspondent was sharing an anecdote with me. That is one out of the room, 1, 2, 3, that the chief ministers of every states was questioned for their schemes. So the planning commission was approving the state plans, okay, and then sending it. Every schemes of the line ministries was first approved there in the planning commission, and then this was going to expenditure. So you know, you have that kind of bureaucracy. The government start functioning, let's say in 2011, the scheme is drafted, this first goes to the planning commissions, the same set of civil servants are looking at those schemes for various parameters, and then this goes to expenditure. So they will take another 6-7 months or so. By the time you launch that schemes, this government is going for the poll.
By the time the person who sent it to planning commission actually came to planning commission.
Absolutely, absolutely. So that kind of hurdles, I think this government has to remove. This bureaucracy need to be more functional.
They have removed. I mean, they have removed that part.
They have removed that. They have removed that. So that's what.
So coming to you, Ravi, I wanted to actually ask you a question. So in your case also, do you think it has been the case of too many cooks spoiling the broth? Everyone jumped into fintech because first of all, no one knew there's something called fintech. And then regulator, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of IT, Prana, Dikna, everyone getting into it.
So I think, you know, leading on from the remarks that you just made, and since we have possibly two other bureaucrats sitting at the table, I think bureaucratic infighting is nothing new. It's been around since the time of the Roman Empire. It happened in the Soviet Union, it happens in communist China, it happens in the United States. It's absolutely nothing new. This is how life is, right?
And business rivalries.
Absolutely. I mean, I work for Lucent Technologies. I mean, it was hard for me to make sure that two departments didn't work at cross purposes. It happens all the time. We are human beings, we love to argue, it's nothing about Amartya Sen, but this is how it is, right? Now, the specific and then the general. The specific in my case, in our case, is that there are three or four key pieces of legislation where the legislators understand that this is not the subject on which the parliament can make laws. So my favorite example is the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. So there is an omnibus section there called rules under PMLA. The rules are drafted by experts, right? And the interpretation of those rules is done by the Reserve Bank. Specifically in the banking and financial services sector, with again my apologies to my colleagues from the IAS here, the banking nationalization in 1969 was one of the biggest mistakes ever made. Okay, it was a massive mistake. I have to say though that since 1991 across governments, the mitigation for that has also been very intelligent. There has been no Boris Yeltsin style privatization. It has been a gradual letting in of the private sector. So from 100% we went to 65%. The reason I bring this up is that the Ministry, the Department of Financial Services, plays a very, very big role in how financial services is delivered in the country, right? They essentially run, you know, 65% of the banking system in the country. So legislation very often falls between, or the interpretation between the Reserve Bank and the Department of Financial Services. In my own case, just as to share an anecdote, there was no legal basis on which my payment system, which was designed to reach the unbanked, in the form of cash, which iceberg doesn't like, existed. After many, many discussions with the Reserve Bank said, look, this is a question of law, not a question of interpretation. So if you need something to be interpreted in this case, you must go to the Ministry of Finance. So through the hard way, I went and talked to various people. Finally, I reached the Secretary of Financial Services at that time, a gentleman called D.K. Mittal, and talked to Dangarajan, who was a professor at IIM Ahmedabad. He was the chairman of the Economic Advisory Council. So they said, we've heard your case. It was actually remarkably objective. And within 2 days, the Reserve Bank of India produced this circular called the DMT circular, which allows money transfers to the unbanked. Okay. Now, this whole process took something like 2 years for me. And then the NPCI stepped in, and then we had to go to the RBI and tell them that either a market infrastructure provider provides infrastructure or is a market participant, but you can't be both. It violates any principle of markets. The Reserve Bank again took a very principled stance and told Mr. Hota to back off. So that's how we got to operate. All of this took 3 to 4 years. The implication is that I could not attract a single rupee of private equity investment. No VC would invest in us. No bank would work with us. I funded all of this out of my own pocket for 3-4 years. It's something that you don't have to necessarily make an entrepreneur, go through. So to that extent, I think if there was political will to make sure that these kinds of policy clashes and bureaucratic clashes didn't happen, we should have an easier time of it, as we move towards a $5 trillion economy, because I agree that these things should not derail the way we go about things.
You wanted to say
something? I just wanted to tell ki infighting or tendency to have a mutually conflicting stance, it's not exactly limited to government, but yes, it is there. And how do you solve it? So if you have a very clear decision-making process, in case of infighting between two arms of the government, who's going to be the decision maker? And if he is a decisive decision maker with suitable powers, so that takes care of lots of issues. So I think it's may not be that much an important issue as far as my scheme is concerned. But I definitely feel ki, yes, this it is for me basically to ensure that the schemes continues for next 5 years, 10 years, 20 years properly by having a consistent policies and procedures.
So
on this multiplicity of...
See, there's actually, in the Indian Administrative Service, there's a very sophisticated system, very sophisticated mechanism of conflict resolution. It's very informal. It happens through phone calls and so on. No papers may be written and so on.
What is the system?
Of conflict resolution within the services. It's a very, very sophisticated system, and it has been going on since the British time, from the ICS times and so on. And now, if the same function is taken care of by different ministries, typically it is addressed perhaps by the cabinet secretary, etc., etc. And though formally you may not see something, one department seems to take the lead. I mean, that's what we tend to see. So sometimes it's okay to let many departments do the same thing, because internally there is a decision that has already been taken, which you and I don't get this. Sometimes that does happen. But I'll go back. I think the larger problem is that of, are the boundaries between various government organizations well defined? And the answer, and your problem is actually coming from that. Because when the boundary is not well defined, then the RBI will not take ownership over who is to regulate NPCI, though technically it should. The Ministry of Finance may also not take ownership. So when the boundary is not clear, who is going to take care of that no man's land is the problem. In the case of NPCI, it's a huge success. Everyone within the government seems to love it, because this is something very Indian, come from Indian innovation, Indian money, Indian efforts, people close to the government in the past avatar, all came together and built this amazing mechanism. So to dislodge it from its amazing power is going to be difficult for anyone. I have actually been writing a lot on this particular issue, and it's been many years. So this is an entity that effectively controls all of electronic or digital payments in India. It is owned by the commercial banks. Now what happens is, the way it operates is, it is highly, highly biased towards the commercial banks, and a whole range of Indian new innovative new ideas are getting constrained because of that. This is a well-known problem, but in the government, that is the second part of this whole process, is when the boundaries are ill-defined, things don't move very cleanly. If the boundary is ill-defined, things cannot move cleanly. Now, suppose I am RBI, and I say, okay, fine, I decide NPCI, I'm going to go ahead and privatize you, and I'm going to regulate you. If I go ahead and say that, the Ministry of Finance will be the first one. How can you get rid of a national jewel? Right? Similarly, the other way around may also happen. So boundaries are not well-defined in the Indian governance structure is a huge problem, and we don't recognize or realize how difficult it gets. We feel that a strong PMO, a whole lot of people have felt that a strong PMO is the only way to get around this. And I think they are all wrong. Because even the PMO will get muddled in this whole thing. Because the PMO, whom does the PMO ask for advice? But I'm not talking about the PM, the PMO. Who does? It's the same people who are fighting with each other over their boundaries. So it doesn't, the whole system collapses with these fuzzy boundaries.
So Tanuj, you may not have an answer for this, but this is actually, I think, a single biggest point of failure for what you are trying to do. You are at the intersection of technology and policy. You try to create an enabling technology environment. You try to say that, okay, now we've got this great thing called a sectoral stack, and it is going to drive a huge economy and an ecosystem, and new jobs and new opportunities are going to come around it. And then you get into this trap of things not being very well defined, gray areas, judicial overreach, civil society overreach, and all of that. So have you given it any thought as to how do you firewall what you're trying to do from all this?
Yeah, we have. See, the other thing that's happening is, at least in some areas that where I work, is that it's getting hard to define technology or this new innovation itself, where it is and where it lies. A simple example that is perplexing central bankers all over the world is cryptocurrency. Is it tech? Is it just a database distributed? Is it a currency? Is it an asset? Is it a token? Is it a security? How do we regulate this, right? So sometimes, as a society, forget bureaucrats or government as a subset, as a society, we've not figured out what we've come up with. The internet is a very good example. Yesterday's debate on what is data, whose data is it anyway. Very good example of us inventing something we don't fully understand yet. What is the best way to deal with it? Create a new institution. The NPCI worked because when they had to get banks, the central bank, commercial banks, new operators, all of them working together, they said, okay, let's have a market infrastructure player, new company, partially owned by the government, partially owned by the banks. To their credit, they've had some successes and they have some overreach, right? None of you are wrong. But overall, it's much better than had this been run by, say, the DFS. Had the DFS been responsible for creating an electronic payment system, they would do an RFP, there'd be Infosys, Wipro, TCS, they would take 3 years to do it. You know, like how the India Post upgrade has taken too long, right? The tender came out in 2011, it's finally being implemented this year, right? So in some sense, we are getting better at that problem, we are not perfect. But the answer is specialized institutions. You want to create a national ID program, where does it go? Does it go back to NPR, which started in 2005, did nothing? Or do you create a new UIDAI? Right? Specialized institutions for specialized problems. Seems like a simple answer.
That's wonderful. I think that Ayushman Bharat is an example of that.
NHA.
And yeah. Your UIDI is an example of that. NPCI is an example of that. So I think we are entering an era where we should have lots of very specialized institutions looking at very micro areas. So with that, I come to the audience round. Any questions we have for the panel?
एक्चुअली हेल्थ सेक्टर जो है ट्राइबिलियन इकोनॉमिक में मेजर पार्ट रोल अदा करने वाला है और हम सबको बताना चाहते हैं कि हेल्थ सेक्टर जो है हम जो है 30% जो है दवा का एक्सपोर्ट करते हैं जेनरिक दवा का वर्ल्ड में बट इसका जो है ड्रॉबैक क्या है कि हमारे जो 80% जो रॉ मटेरियल है वो हम चाइना से इम्पोर्ट करते हैं हम 30% जेनरिक दवा जो है हम एक्सपोर्ट करते हैं वर्ल्ड को बट 80% रॉ मटेरियल हम चाइना को जो है से हम इम्पोर्ट करते हैं तो उस लीक को जो हम कैसे बंद करेंगे
मैं इसका इसलिए जवाब देना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि मैं हैदराबाद में काम किया हूँ और हैदराबाद इंडिया के लिए कह सकते हैं आपकी फार्मा सेक्टर का हब है देखिए ये कई बार बात उठती है कि हम इतना कुछ खरीद रहे हैं इतना कम बेच रहे हैं वो तो अपने आप में एक तय बात है आज हमारे देश में हम ट्रेड डेफिसिट कंट्री हैं हम जितना खरीदते हैं उतना हम एक्सपोर्ट नहीं करते हैं पर ये भी हम नहीं कह सकते कि हम सिर्फ अपने देश में ही सब कुछ बनाएंगे जो कि आज़ादी के बाद हमने 40 साल यही सोचा कि हम ना तो कुछ खरीदेंगे ना कुछ बेचेंगे हमको जो करना है हम अपने देश में बनाएंगे वो मॉडल भी चल नहीं पाया जब हम अपने आप को ग्लोबलाइज करते हैं जब हम अपना ट्रेड बढ़ाते हैं जब हम कुछ बेचते भी हैं कुछ खरीदते भी हैं उन चीज़ों को बेचते हैं जहाँ पर हमें जिसमें ज़्यादा माहिरतें हैं हमारी और उन चीज़ों को हम दुनिया से खरीद रहे हैं जो हम हमारे यहाँ पे अगर हम पैदा करेंगे तो शायद हमें ज़्यादा खर्चा पड़ेगा तो ये ग्लोबल ट्रेड में क्या बेच रहे हैं क्या खरीद रहे हैं ये कोई बहुत गलत बात नहीं है दोनों चीज़ें होती हैं ये भी एक बहुत अच्छी बात आपको याद रखनी पड़ेगी कि आज हिंदुस्तान में आज जो पिछले 25 साल में फार्मास्यूटिकल सेक्टर में जो हमारे यहाँ पर तरक्की हुई है अगर ये नहीं होती और वो सिर्फ उसका एकमात्र कारण है कि हमने जब हमारे ऊपर प्रोसेस पेटेंट और प्रोडक्ट पेटेंट के बीच की लड़ाई चल रही थी 1995 में, अगर हम उस वक्त हमारे पॉलिसी मेकर्स दब गए होते और जो दुनिया हमें बता रही थी वो बात को मान लिया होता, तो आज हमारे यहाँ पे जो ये फार्मास्यूटिकल्स के जो इतने बड़े बड़े इंडिया में जो प्लेयर्स आज तैयार हुए हैं, बहुत बड़ी सक्सेस स्टोरी है हमारी फार्मास्यूटिकल्स में। आज जो दवाइयाँ आपको देश में 1 रुपये में मिल रही है, आज वही दवाई आज दुनिया की किसी भी दुकान में आप जाके देखें तो शायद 20-25 रुपये में मिल रही है। आज भी जो हमारी फार्मास्यूटिकल सेक्टर है, नॉट जस्ट फॉर दवाई बनाना पर दवाई के डिस्कवरी में भी आज भारत का बहुत मेजर योगदान है पूरे फार्मास्यूटिकल के सेक्टर में, अपने आप में एक सक्सेस स्टोरी है। पर ये भी एक बात है कि लड़ाई जारी है, आज भी हमारी जारी है। आज US के साथ में हमारी लड़ाई किस बात के लिए है कि हम लोगों ने कैप लगा दिया है। हम लोगों ने आजकल एक बात और लेकर कहा गया है कि हम ब्रांड के नाम से नहीं बेची जाएगी कोई भी दवाई जिसके ऊपर एक अपना टैक्स होता है, अपना एक टैग होता है, अपनी एक प्रीमियम वैल्यू होती है, हम उसमें फॉर्मुलेशंस की बात करने लग गए। तो काफ़ी हद तक हमारी एक फार्मा एक सक्सेस स्टोरी है। ये ज़रूर बात है कि जितना हम खरीदते हैं उतना हम दुनिया में नहीं बेच पा रहे, पर आज हमारी बहुत सारी कंपनीज़ हैं जो ग्लोबल बड़ी कंपनीज़ की सप्लाई चेन्स की पार्ट हैं और वो एक अपने आप में बहुत सक्सेस की बात है। एक जस्ट कमिंग बैक टू दैट पार्ट दैट वॉज अबाउट द ब्यूरोक्रेसीज एंड द साइलोज एंड स्पेशलाइज्ड एजेंसीज, यू नो, to be very honest with the country of our size and dimensions and the country of the size of our problems, it's a fact, and I think all of you would agree that for every 1 million problems solved in the country, it's only one problem that surfaces out and comes out open. So we should also be mindful of that. There are a lot of people, a lot of public servants who actually are trying to solve these problems. Interministerial consultation koi tussle nahi hai. In a democratic society, you need to have interministerial consultation. You may have a viewpoint. For example, मैं अगर रोड बनाता हूँ तो मेरा तो एक ही मकसद रहेगा कि मुझे रोड बनाना है, पर रोड बनाने के लिए पैसा चाहिए तो मुझे एटलीस्ट फाइनेंस से तो पूछना पड़ेगा ना कि भाई आज देश की प्रायोरिटी में कौन कहाँ फिट हो रहा है। तो अपने आप में इंटर मिनिस्ट्रियल कंसल्टेशन कोई बुरी बात नहीं है। अच्छा, दूसरी बात यह भी है कि बिजनेस को एक तरफ चाहिए स्पीड, दूसरी तरफ बिजनेस को चाहिए कंसल्टेशन, तो दोनों के बीच में एक बैलेंस बिठाना भी अपने आप में एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट बात है। एंड one more point here is that to achieve this $5 trillion economy objective, jo ki hamara is pure top ye session ka jo main core maqsad hai, hum log jo aapas mein baithe hue baat kar rahe hain, iske liye hame sabse jo important hai hamari factor economies. ultimately to puri jo bhi economy hai wo 3 factors pe depend karti hai, land labor capital. aaj hamari land labor capital ki agar economies ko hum theek nahi karenge, durust nahi karenge, to hamara ye 5 trillion ka dream hi reh jayega, achieve nahi ho payega. तो यहाँ पर रिफॉर्म्स का बहुत महत्वपूर्ण रोल रहेगा और उन रिफॉर्म्स को बहुत तेज़ी से लाने के ऊपर भी बहुत महत्वपूर्ण रोल रहेगा। तो कम से कम ये एक बात हुई है पिछले कई सालों में कि हमारे रिफॉर्म्स बहुत तेज़ी से आ रहे हैं, हर सेक्टर में बहुत तेज़ी से आ रहे हैं, और जो पहले वक्त लग रहा था ये जो आपस में एक दूसरे के बीच में बात करना, ज़्यादा बात करना, ज़्यादा वक्त देना, वो सब चीज़ों को काफ़ी हद तक काट दिया गया है। और आप ये मान के चलिए कि दो ब्यूरोक्रेट्स, जो आपने बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट बात की कि एक इनफॉर्मल मैकेनिज्म बहुत हमारे देश में है, आज चिट्ठियां लिखी जाती होंगी पहले, पर आजकल सबसे पहले फ़ोन उठाया जाता है, इंटरकॉम उठाया जाता है, एक दूसरे से बात की जाती है, एंड दैट इज़ हाउ यू आर सीइंग सो मेनी रिफॉर्म्स कमिंग इन टू शेप। वी हैव ऑल वर्कड इन स्टेट गवर्नमेंट्स एंड नाउ वी हैव कम टू गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। आई हैव नेवर सीन गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया बींग सो एजाइल, बिकॉज इट टेक्स टाइम, इट्स अ ह्यूज एंटरप्राइज फॉर अ कंट्री ऑफ 125 crore पीपल टू बी given a particular policy or a program. अब आप देखिए, एक 6 महीने के अंदर आयुष्मान भारत की विवेचना से लेके कंसेप्चुलाइजेशन से लेके संरचना तक और आज उसके एक्टिव इम्प्लीमेंटेशन तक का काम एक डेढ़ साल में हो गया, जबकि ऐसा नहीं, पहले संभव नहीं था। तो काफ़ी हद तक एक एजिलिटी है और इस एजिलिटी का सबसे बड़ा कारण ही यह है कि एक एवरीबडी हैज़ बीन गिवन एन आउटकम ओरिएंटेशन एंड इट्स अ फैक्ट। आज की तारीख में आप किसी भी ब्यूरोक्रेट से आप बात कर लीजिए, भारत सरकार या किसी भी जहाँ महकमे में किसी भी डिपार्टमेंट में अगर वो काम कर रहा है, एवरीबडी हैज़ बीन गिवन अ प्रॉपर आउटकम ओरिएंटेशन, एवरीबडी हैज़ बीन सेड टोल्ड वेरी इन क्लियर टर्म्स दैट द कंट्रीज इकोनॉमी इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी बिल्ट बाय यू, द कंट्रीज इकोनॉमी इज गोइंग टू बी बिल्ट बाय बिजनेसेस, बाय पार्टनर्स ऑफ द इकोनॉमी, एंड इट इज़ योर जॉब टू इंश्योर दैट यू इनेबल दोज बिजनेसेस, You bring down the deficiencies and the red tape that was causing harm to those businesses and ensure that the businesses and the processes are getting eased up. So, ek apne aap mein ek bahut important ye orientation hai aur kisi bhi economy ko bada hona hai, to I think these are the basic minimum factors jo kisi economy ko upar leke jayenge. I just thought I'll give a perspective of the sarkar.
No, I really appreciate and value these comments. The fact, sir, also remains that more businesses have left India in the last 5 years than before, and there are very real reasons. So let us not get blown by our own successes and understand the reality of the problem, and there is a very serious problem. A small informal business, whether it is a ready wala or a press wala, will never want his child to become, to open another business. I'm starting from there. He will want him to get a government job. Anything but a small business. A small scale industrialist will not want today his children to start a small scale industry. And this trend is worsening. That is the reality of India today. The 5 trillion economy objective does not mean that we will reach it with small or businesses. It means that the way the government is working, we are going to go with the large businesses. Yes, there will be defense production, there may be large financial sector investments, etc., etc. With every objective, you give up on some things. We have given up effectively as of today on the small and micro business because there is a problem there which the government is unable to even comprehend. Forget about find a solution to. And there is a businessman amongst us and he can say, this is a serious problem. This is not about talking to a public. The government does not know what the problem with the small business is. And the number of businesses are falling. Even the government's own data is showing that. The number of businessmen shifting to India, to Singapore, to the US, to Europe, is actually not small. And those numbers are also out there in the market. So there is a serious problem. What that problem is not necessarily the problem caused by the government. And let me get it very clear. It could be a structural shift that in this day and age, perhaps small businesses are not required. I don't know the answer. It could be something that the government has done. It could be that the technologies are changing. But without proper understanding of this, we will be losing out on the small business character of India, which seems to be apparent. But the $5 trillion is not about small businesses. It is not about inclusion. It is about a top-level number. And that number we will achieve. The question is, how are we going to achieve it? Does it make sense, and I will just leave it at that, to achieve a 5 trillion number where you are actually reducing the number of small businesses in India?
Just to complement, just to supplement what Lavish, you're very absolutely correct. You know, while we were before the session started, the one point that came in was to get this $5 trillion economy dream achieved. I think we will require a fresh set of entrepreneurs and businessmen to come to the country. I mean, it's a fact. There are existing businesses which are to an extent fading away or going down because of not just a structural shift. We should also appreciate that it's now a disruption economy. I mean, the economies are disrupting because of the fact that technologies are changing. The businesses which were viable 10 years back are no longer viable now because the technology of doing that particular business has changed altogether. And so you are going to have new technologies, new businesses which will get evolved. So over a period of time, that shift has to come.
I think, you know, Mr. Jaju, I think Lavish makes an important point. So as an entrepreneur who gave up whatever idea, and I'm very happy to be here, by the way, let me put something to you guys. Your government, I mean, the Prime Minister has had a huge mandate in 2019. It's a very good mandate. This is political capital that has been earned on the basis of 5 years of a government before that, where admittedly there were a couple of mistakes, but people recognize that this is where hope lies and they put their faith in you. If there was one thing that I'd like government to look at, and I think I made this point earlier in another panel as well, it is this. Please, don't run any businesses. Your job, if I may say, is to create, see, there are essentially three types of equity, right? There's political equity, There is social equity and there is economic equity that Lavish and I talk about, investment, numbers, ROI, etc. If your government focuses entirely on creating the social equity,
our government,
if it focuses entirely on creating the social equity, I'm not saying therefore don't take your eye off the border or something like that, but if the focus is on social equity, it solves a lot of problems. Let me tell you this. Lavish is absolutely right about businesses. My father, who is a government servant, Padma Shri and all of that, he, looking at my struggles in the last 10 years, asks me, "Kis kisam ka gadha tha tu? Why did you give up everything in Paris and come here? You're already getting screwed here." Okay? This same discussion is what every father has with his son who is running a business. What are Indians good at doing? We are very good risk takers. We are savers, we are hard workers, we invest in social networks. Why? Because there is no social safety network anywhere. All our conveniences that we take for are granted in the cities are private conveniences. A private school, a private gas connection, a nice condo, 2 cars, 5 servants to do our bidding for us. These are all private networks that we built because we have the economic capability to do it. But if you want, not me, to take risks, but if you want a kid in the village to say, "Main jaake abhi dukaan kholunga," he must have the assurance that when he gets married and has children, his children will go to a good school, that he has reasonable health care, that no government servant is going to harass him, that he does not have law and order problems because of some caste war or something like that. If your focus could be on building this social equity, okay, and unleash the animal spirits of Indian entrepreneurs. Why is it that Indian entrepreneurs do very well in the United States? Not because they have some magic sauce over there, because they go there, find a level playing field. If you work hard, you have a great idea, we give you money. You failed once, it's okay, because you're not going to fail again. It creates all these entrepreneurs. Try it, because you're not going to get to 5 trillion. You can get to 5 trillion through compound interest, as Mr. Chidambaram pointed out, so that's fine. But if you want to get to 5 trillion in a reasonably small period of time, I would request that the government stay out of business other than providing predictable regulation and fair legislation. These are two very important objectives. If you stay out of it and let private entrepreneurs do what they need to do, invest big or small and create new generation of risk takers, this country will, you know, it'll do extremely well in the next 15, 20 years. And for Mr. Modi and the government, this would be the greatest legacy they can leave.
I think on that note, we come to an end of this panel.